Good afternoon. Welcome. Good afternoon. Welcome and thank you for dialing in for our webinar today. Your Excellencies, our Dean of Vocational Studies of IPB University, Dr. Insinyur Arif Daryanto, Master of Economics, our Vice Dean of Vocational Studies of IPB, Dr. Bagus Priyo Purwanto, Master of Agronomy, our Dean of Vocational Studies, Dr. Insinyur Wawan Oktariza, and our Senate Colleague of Vocational Studies of IPB University, Dr. Daisy Tambayong, our distinguished guest, University and Industrial Participants, I would like to welcome you all to our webinar today. I'm greatly honored to have this opportunity to host this webinar. My name is Judith Vega, and I'm a faculty member here at the Vocational Studies of IPB University. This webinar is a part of our third International Summer Course on Sustainability of Tropical Animal Production, Creating Innovation in the New Normal Era, held on July 5th to 16th, 2021. Today, we'll be discussing innovation in integrated animal sector in new normal era and featuring Dr. Desianto Budi Utomo, PhD from Caron Pokpan, Indonesia, Dr. Insinyur Dedi Jusadi, Master of Science from IPB University, and Dr. Marcel Pasaribu from Interfet, Indonesia. You can expect each speaker to have the floor for about 30 minutes, and we'll conduct two short Q&A session. If you have any question during the webinar, please type them into the chat window. We'll address them during the Q&A. By the end of our time today, we hope you feel more comfortable and confident about the topic. We're very passionate about the topic and have many exciting stories and learning to share here today. We'll start with opening session, which will be presented by our Vice Dean colleague of Vocational Studies, Dr. Insinyur Bagus Priyo Purwanto, Master of Agronomy. Are you joining with us, Dr. Bagus? Pak Bagus?
Yes.
Okay, Pak Bagus, are you ready?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay, Pak Bagus, the Zoom is yours.
Thank you, Ms. Judith. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the international webinar organized by our vocational college entitled Innovation. Today, we'll entitled Innovation Integrated Animal Sector in New Normal Era. The webinar is a part of the summer course program that we hosted by our college. We appreciate you for taking time of your busy schedule to join to this webinar. I would like to express my gratitude to Pak Arif Daryanto, Dean of IPB Vocational College, Pak Desianto, PT Caron Pokpan Indonesia, Pak Didi Yusadi, Department of Agriculture, IPB University, and Pak Marcel Pasaribu from PT Interpet Indonesia for being keynote speakers on this webinar. Ladies and gentlemen, the COVID-19 pandemic has impacted on the second food supply chain, especially in livestock and fisheries production and veterinary services. Cluster of cases among workers in the meat processing plant improved quickly, influencing the human, animal, and environment welfare in several countries. In processing plants, the hygienic focus is on quality and food safety. The impact of COVID-19 are on the production process. To ensure food security in the face of this great challenge, a global transformation is needed. The food shortage may also occur globally. Many livestock farmers fail to get animal health services, showing that the livestock health become a challenge in the food production. Ladies and gentlemen, in the afternoon, on the other hand, the Economic Forum states that the COVID-19 pandemic has become a catalyst for education, institutional and infrastructure sector to develop innovation that would help the farmer to overcome this challenge. Aside from that, the limited active number of workers due to the lockdown policy has become an obstacle in the animal and fish production process. To overcome this situation, today we will learn from our speakers' practices on the use of technological innovation to increase fish and livestock production, and also how the veterinary services use digital system for services and extension. Ladies and gentlemen, in the end, I sincerely wish to you, wish from this webinar, you will have a productive day in interesting and stimulating discussion. Thank you for your attention, and wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Pak Bagus. Ladies and gentlemen, before we dive in, let's take photo session which will be conducted by Mr. Danang, SPIC. Mr. Danang, are you ready to take the photo shoot?
Yes, Miss Vega. Okay, please turn on the camera. There are 7 slides. Okay, slide 1. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Slide 2. 1, 2, 3. Okay, next slide. 1, 2, 3. Okay. 1, 2, 3. Okay, the last slide. 1, 2, 3. Okay, thank you. Speaking.
Okay, thanks, Mr. Danang. Now I will introduce our moderator today, Dr. Heriudianto Vibowo, Master of Science. Okay, Dr. Heriudianto Vibowo is one of our lecturer in SVIPB University. I will read his bio. Dr. Heriu, are you joining with us?
Yes.
Okay, I will read your bio first.
Thank you.
But the slide is not changed.
It's already changed, Mrs. Vega.
Okay. Heriu Dianto, his educational background, he is Bachelor of Veterinary Medicine in 2008, and in 2010 he is Doctor of Veterinary Medicine. In 2018 he is a Master of Science in Veterinary Biomedical Sciences. He has several research and papers. The first is about the effect of pseudoaerorhizomic ethanol extract toward clinical sign of pre and post surgery in tumor induced rabbit in 2007 and 2008, sequence gastrotherapy technique in Kunbel dwarf hamster in 2010, hemogram and tissue response in incisional hernia of pig post therapy of polypropylene mesh without
hyaluronic acid.
Okay, 2016. And the effect of local cat's weight of bird on teeth growth and weight gain in 2013. Well, his organization is one of the Indonesian Veterinary Medical Association 2010 until now. Asosiasi Groomer Indonesia 2017 until present. And the last is Asosiasi Dokter Hewan Satwa Liar Akuatik dan Hewan Eksotik Indonesia Asli Hewan 2018 until present. Okay, Dok Heriu, the time is yours.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Vega. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Good morning and good afternoon for all of the participants. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce myself again. My name is Heriudianto, and I am the moderator of today's webinar. I'm very pleased to be here and welcome all of you to this webinar series. And the topic for this international webinar is innovation in integrated animal sector in a normal era. As Mrs. Vega have said, we have three distinguished speakers, all of this wonderful. The first is Dr. Desianto Budi Utomo. He is a regional director of PT Charun Pokpan Indonesia. And he will give a talk about innovation in integrated poultry sector during a pandemic. The second one is Dr. Dedi Jusadi. He is a senior lecturer and researcher in aquaculture department of IPB University. He will talk about potential of local raw material for fish feed. And the last speaker is Dr. Adrianus Marcel M. Pasaribu. He is an account manager, companion animal of MSD Animal Health or PT Intervet Indonesia. And he will talk about creating innovation of the veterinary industry. I would like to welcome Dr. Desianto, Dr. Dedi, and Dr. Marcel. Is Dr. Marcel is here with us now?
Is Dr. Yes, Marcel? He already with us.
Oh, okay, good. Thank you. Hello, Dr. Marcel. Okay, nice to finally meeting you. But before we start the presentation, I would like to inform to our lovely speakers that our presentation will run for about 20 minutes for each speaker. The first, I will give the time to the first speaker, Dr. Desianto Budi Utomo. And the second speaker will be Dr. Dedi Jusadi. And the last speaker will be Dr. Marcel Pasaribu. Okay, after the presentation is done, we will continue our session with Q&A or discussion session. Audience who wants to ask can give their question by giving the question via chat room or giving the question directly by using the raise hand feature in your Zoom application. Now we move on to our presentation session, but before that, please allow me to read all of the speaker curriculum vitae. For the first speaker is Dr. Desianto Budi Utomo. His educational background, in 1980 until 1986, he joined the Doctor of Veterinary Medicine in Erlangga University, Indonesia. In 91 until 92, he joined the Tropical Animal Production and Health for his MSc in the University of Edinburgh, Scotland. And in 92 until 93, he joined the Poultry Nutrition for his MPhil in also in University of Edinburgh, Scotland. And for his PhD in poultry physiology, he joined the Roslin Institute Scotland in 93 until 96. His working experience, he is an OTC sales representative for Pfizer International Indonesia at 86 until 87. And then he became the nutrition consultant for Agrotech Corporation in Surabaya in 96 until 97. Assistant researcher at Roslin Institute of Edinburgh in 95 until 96. And then he is also a lecturer and researcher at Veterinary Medicine Faculty of Erlangga University from 97 until 2000. He was a researcher at Institute of Animal Physiology and Genetic Research of Edinburgh in 93 until 95. He was a manager of R&D division for Charun Pokpan Jaya Farm in Tangerang in 2000 until 2005. He also a nutritionist coordinator for the CPI group in Jakarta in 2005 until 2008. Now he is a vice president of feed technology for CPI Jakarta from 2004 until now. He is also a liaison officer of government and academic for CPI in 2008 until now. He was head of Indonesia Premix business for CV Group Singapore in 2016 until 2017. And also he is now a expert in food security for Export Work Group, BPK Ministry of Agriculture from 2018 until now. For the second speaker, he is Dr. Dedi Jasudi. He is joined the Fisheries Bachelor majoring in Aquaculture in 1987 in IPB University, and then continue his education in Magister in Fish Nutrition in Tokyo University, and then continue his PhD also in fish nutrition in Tokyo University of Marine Science and Technology. His professional experience, he is a lecturer and researcher in Bogor Agricultural University from 1988 until now. He was the head of Animal Department of Aquaculture, Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science in Bogor Agricultural University. He was a head of department again in 2004 until 2008. He was a vice dean of graduate school in IPB University in 2008 until 2012. He was also an academic senate member of IPB University at 2006 until 2008. And now he is a senate member of the Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science from 2017 until 2021. One of his publication and paper is SINTA, Science and Technology Index, and the Scopus Author ID. And the last one is Dr. Adrianus Marcel Martino Pasaribu. His educational background, he joined the Doctor of Veterinary Medicine at IPB University from 2009 until 2015. His working experience, he was an internship at the Hospital Veterinary University, University Putra Malaysia. He was a technical sales representative for PT SHS International in 2015 until 2016. He was also product specialist at PT SHS in 2017 until 2018. And now he is an account manager, companion animal for MSD Animal Health, from 2018 until now. Okay, so we will continue to our presentation. I would like to welcome Dr. Desianto to give his presentation. Please, Dr. Desianto.
Thank you, Dr. Heryu. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Siang, good morning and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen around the world. Maybe you are joining from different countries, even different continent. I would like to share in within 20 minutes, Pak Heryu, ya?
25 minutes.
Okay. Can I share my screen? Okay, thank you. Within the next 25 minutes, I would like to share my perspective of the innovation in integrated poultry sector during the pandemic. Maybe less pandemic will be discussed in this paper, but I would like more concern regarding the issue on the innovation within the integrated poultry sector. I would like to start with the introducing for those who are not familiar with Cawdon Pokpat Indonesia. This brief story, history, we were established in 1972 in Jakarta, first office and first factory we built. And then our vision is feeding a growing world with the mission to produce and market the highest quality and innovative feed, DOC, and food products. Line of the business, including poultry feed business, poultry farming, producing the DOC for food, parent stock, and also final stock, and also processed food. The number of employees without the contract workers in 2019, we are about 7,000 something. And with total annual sales for the year of 2019 was 58 trillion. Just very brief. And also we would like to introduce you regarding the Charun Pokpan Foundation, which delivering our CSR funding to those who are needing, including the education project, community development, and national disaster alleviation. For the education, we have been started with IPD first before we have been establishing the relationship very long time ago, including the scholarship from primary until university, early childhood support, and also teachers' character building, joining with the University of Diponegoro Semarang. In the community development, our Charun Pokpan Foundation also building the village infrastructure, including maintenance for the road and bridges, and renovating and establish musola or mosque for prayer for the Muslim, including posyandu, integrated health and nutrition service station for local communities. For the national disaster, we do help people during the national disaster by supporting donation food and also clothes, et cetera. This brief of our company. And this afternoon, within the next 23 minutes, I would like to share regarding the genetic changes in the poultry, the closed house, and also why we are entering industry 4.0 and challenge faced by the poultry industry. Let's start with the genetic changes. As we know that the broiler in this country, in Indonesia, contributing about 65% of the total animal protein sources compared with the ruminants only about 16%. So by having 65% of the contributing, the major source of the animal protein, this is by the poultry industry becoming strategic industry which has been protecting by the government so far for not importing the product, poultry product from other countries. But we are not supposed to do so because we think it's only a matter of time. Sooner or later, imported poultry product will be coming to this country. That's why we are expecting to be more efficient, to be able to head-to-head, neck-to-neck, to be comparing and having the competition with, say, for the Latin America, for Brazil and Argentina. This is the genetic improvement for the carcass percentage in 1990, only 65%, but now almost 75%. For the breast percentage, only 15% in 1990, now almost 25%. And fat reduction from 2% becoming 1.5%. So within the last 20 years, there is 40% breast meat yield more within the 20 years selection. In the beginning, in 1970, we are only targeting body weight for the traits we are selecting, we have been selecting so far. But in the year 2000, the traits has been developed not only for the targeting for the body weight, but also feed conversion ratio, breast meat composition, etc. And even today, more than 40 traits has been selected as the consideration for the selection and breeding program. Genetic changes within, as I mentioned, in 1990, the body weight within 35 days reached only 1.38, but now we have been developing and selecting becoming 2.6 in the 2020 in terms of body weight. But also in terms of the FCR, feed conversion ratio, starting 1.9 in 1990, becoming 1.3 in 2020. So more than 20% efficient in terms of a dividend within 20 years. We know that the performance is really affecting by genetic substances, environment, and nutrition, but time is management, including this environmental condition. That's where we are really concerning about environmental condition, how on earth the bird can be more feeling comfortable in the during the rearing in the chicken house. Now that's where we are moving to the converting open house to the closed house system. We know that there is a limitation of land for crops and for the livestock. In the meantime, we are comparing in 1970, every person has 0.38 hectare per capita for the arable land to be planted for the agriculture, but within 80 years, becoming lost from 0.38 hectare per capita, becoming only 0.15 hectare per capita. So available land is declining 60%. In the meantime, the protein demand still keep growing up. Agriculture price will continue to be strong in the long run. This is the message of this limited land due to the shrinkage of the surface area of the globe, as well as for the increasing the sea level surface. Growing concern on the productivity, livestock have a considered impact on the environment. Increase, that's why we are trying to increase the productivity. In the meantime, also minimizing or reducing the environmental impact. We know that the pollution waste from the industrial livestock can pollute water supplies, and for the environmental degradation, overstocking land with grazing animal can cause also soil erosion, desertification, and the loss of the plant diversity. And in addition, we are facing the public health hazard with growing number of the intensification of the urban and suburban livestock production may cause serious impact to the public health issue. That's why now we are trying to minimizing both for the environmental concern as well as for the pollution concern. During now, we know that industry has to be more difficult keeping and facing the keep changing world under VUCA, more volatile, more uncertainty, more complexity, and ambiguity. Volatility has already driven fast-growing digital era, brings a fast and dynamic changes. For those who are not ready to follow the changes, will be left behind by the competition, global competition. In the same time, we are also facing the uncertainty. There are a lot of things becoming uncertain in current situation, even more in the future, including when we are not suffering from the COVID-19. There is nobody knows when it will be finished. Complexity, too much information and factors can influence the complicated problems. Well, in the meantime, we have to make a decision. This more complicated. And as well as the ambiguity, unclear and not as accurate information, and even contradictory, which may lead to the difficult condition whenever we are trying to draw a conclusion. Thus, VUCA already been driving to the economic crisis, political crisis, public health issue, and also disruption technology. Why we are moving to closed house? Closed house technology is to answer some of the poultry industry problems, including improving the broiler performance to match the genetic potential that they have been already been selected, including FCR, mortality, and European economic factor. Under hot climate, we know that Indonesia is classified as a hot and hotter, stressful environment. This may not suitable for growing big chicken for during the finisher time. Plus host is also will be the answer for limiting speed that we have already discussed earlier, and also enabling improvement in input productivity and increase the efficiency by increase the density and less mortality and less number of workers. And overall, by applying closed host system, closed host technology, it improves the performance in all parameters to compare to the open host system. Providing such convenience and comfort to the chicken, which improving the situation and condition for the chicken, which makes less stress, less potential disease challenge, also less exposure to the any pathogenic microorganism. It means it's also less air pollution and reduced smell by having the closed house system. We do concern about QCD, the quality, the cost, the delivery. There is no point to return as when the global competitiveness and modern industrialization has to be taken away. We do have to concern about the globalization, including the global market and global competitiveness. That's where we are really concerned about the cost and the quality, also the delivery of the product. This is the picture of the broiler open house. Majority still under open house in Indonesia for broiler. This some being converted to the closed house system. This is some of the closed house system under Indonesia condition. This is the performance. If we compare open to closed house, within 32 days now, this last year performance actually is not this year. Open under open sided hosting system 1.78. In the meantime, body weight in the 32 days already 2.2. With the fit index 2.9 in the open and 3.2 in the closed house. For the adjusted FCR 1.64 compared to 1.47. It means that 1.47 kg needed to increase the 1 kilo life body weight. In comparison to open house, need 1.64 kg to increase 1 kilogram body weight. And finally, we end up with the viscous analysis. Viscous using the open house for live kilogram body weight costs us 10,700 something. In the meantime, for the closed house only 9,492 rupiah only for the feed cost per kilogram live body weight. Now we are adopting the technology, including the industry 4.0. What is the coverage for the industry 4.0 by go digital, artificial intelligence, applying machine learning, robotic and automation, big data analytics, blockchain technology, including digital twin of farm and factories, robotic process and automation, including Internet of Things. Why Industry 4.0? Because we would like to increase the productivity, to lower the cost, to improve the product quality, to become more innovative and competitive, as well as to gain a competitive advantage. This is what we call as business transformation. We have to transform ourselves to be more competitive, and we are not supposed to be protected by the government law or regulation in order to compete and to face the challenge by importation from the Latin America countries. Industry 4.0 in poultry, including 3D printing, this is not being applicable under commercial condition for, it's not much for the 3D printing, but for the octopus scare fire robot in terms of robotic in the farm, improve litter quality can also be monitoring housing condition, including the nanny robot for the layer, for the CP Pinggu layer in China, already been applying for the race 10,000 hens and monitor the dead birds. It really helps us and also reducing the number of workers. As I mentioned, the treaty is not really only have a little impact for the poultry industry, but some challenge for the using the robotic, the cost factor, waiting for the big companies, the human factor, unemployment issue because we are becoming less utilized worker as for the human being perspective, and also the adoption of the technology. Industry should proactively adopt, not only adapt, but also adopt the enabling technologies that improve its output, improve the quality, as well as improve the efficiency in order to be more competitive to compete with the head-to-head with the Brazilian product. I cited from the Jack Welch, the former CEO from the General Electric. If the rate of change on the outside exceeds the rate of exchange on the inside, so the end is near. That's why we define that there are 8 critical characteristics to high quality learning in the era of the Industrial Revolution. Education of 4.0, including global citizenship skills, just borderless, innovation and creativity skills, technology skill, and the rest are most to the soft skill, including interpersonal skill, personalized and self-paced learning, accessible and inclusive learning, problem-based and collaborative learning, and lifelong and student-driven learning based on the student perspective. This is what we adopt the curriculum should be adopted by curriculum for the coming future, as well as how to be survive and more competitive and secure the student future for the sake of the student future. Poultry sector trends and global challenges. The trend is modern intensive production method. They are moving very fast from the traditional and conventional methodology in terms of rearing birds into the adopting of the technology, including closed house system, genetic improvement by improve the selection and breeding program, improve preventive disease control and biosecurity measures, increasing income and human population. This is the trend of the poultry has already been driven so far. And global challenge, the globalization is among major challenge for Indonesia, given less efficient its industry production. So we are challenged by improving the efficient and in terms of the cost reduction leadership. For the academic perspective challenge in the future, with full of uncertainty, we are not able to see for the next coming future what will be happen because everything becoming uncertain. But otherwise, education has to be more adapting, adaptive to prepare the student to be surviving in the future for both regional and global competition. So, by adjusting the education objective, we are trying to making closer the gap between knowledge of the lectures and the expectation of the student for the future knowledge. But the question is, how can we educate the students something that is unknown and uncertain? This is very difficult for the lecturer to teach the student right now. Alternative solution will be lecturers should no longer just teach how to solve the current or past problem, but they have to make the student be able to solve their future problem, their future issue, instead of the learning what has already been doing and happening in the past. There should be a paradigm shifting from teaching to enabling. Rather than teaching the student, we are trying now, the student has to be able enabling to solve their own problem. Lectures should enable the student to survive in the coming future, not only to understand, but also to be surviving. Now we are facing the challenge, but are being faced by poultry industry. We know that bird population keep increasing, but will be 9 billion in 2045. And today there are a lot of almost 8 billion people on the planet, and expected to reach 9.6 billion by 2050. In the middle class, who typically have more money, purchasing power for buying available for food, leading to greater demand, and could reach 5 billion people by 2030. Feeding this, how on earth we are trying to feed this growing population? For the number one challenge for the agribusiness, as well as it's the greatest opportunity for us to fulfill the opportunity to improve the industry skill of production. Global meat demand keep increasing, and meat consumption has positive correlation with the income and population for the growing countries, although per capita consumption will also peak at certain level, like in the established country, has already been developed country, there are no increase of the meat consumption when the increase of the income. But in the growing and developing country, there is increase of the linearly the meat consumption with the increasing income. In 2030, global meat consumption will reach 388 million tons, or almost 1.5 times higher than what happened in 2011. Well, in 2050, the consumption will be 460 million tons needed to feed the global population. Once the meat consumption per capita meet the highest level, their growth will be flattened regardless the income of or their GDP. If we see the graph in your screen, poultry meat is really going very bigger and dictated the biggest growth until 2050 compared with other animal sources. This is the graph showing us the conventional meat compared in the bottom, compared with the fiction in the green color and the cultured meat. There is no being centralized issue that there is a cultured meat that's been already started and will be coming soon. And in Singaporean already been started for a few supermarket that already sold the cultured meat, but still undergoing the research. The demand for the cultured meat cultivated, and also vegan meat substitute, plant-based meat, conventional meat, and even Bill Gates have stated that all rich countries should move to 100% synthetic beef. This is what Bill Gates already been saying so far. Animal husbandry may become extinct in the coming future, or to put it in context, it will not be as much as needed, since our waste to produce animal feed and to produce animal food will be completely different. There will be a big shifting paradigm if the cultured meat already been socially widely adopted. We know that cultured meat is the process of the farming animal product from cells instead of animals, and it takes nature most element of the building block and cells and cultivate them to become true animal product without the need to raise and slaughter the animals. People will be more healthier and safer and perfectly meet with. Hello?
Dr. Desi, you still have 4 minutes left?
I'm continuing. Okay, 4 minutes.
Yep.
Okay. And this is the challenge of the poultry industry, which will be, is the poultry industry still start the last industry standing to provide the for animal protein source, it will be big question mark for the people, for the animal, for the sake of the world. There is a lot of big campaign to the culture meat, also plant-based meat, also becoming more familiar to those vegetarian and for the vegan. This is the message that livestock should be stopped because it is cruel to the animal, what the animal welfare is saying, because also damaging the environmental, what the environmental activists saying, and also its pollution considered unhealthy because the use of antibiotic. So having said that, the customer trend is having more healthier food and plant-based, vegan, vegetarian, flexitarian are becoming more popular and they are seeking substitute for meat. And lab-grown meat, including meat, culture meat, the plant-based meat market is already well established. While still using serum and fetus is considered not animal friendly. Some other issue may include halal certification, etc. So plant-based, some drawback, plant-based meat is also not good because it has high LCA, life cycle assessment, and also high in sodium and not really wholesome. For the cultured meat, there are a lot of people involved from food scientists, including the microbiologists, and as well as the stem cell scientists. So there are a lot of things that we can be executed together, which is the collaboration between the academician, businessmen, communities, and the government. And the stakeholder, if we collaborate and connection for those all stakeholders involved in the poultry industry. The last question is, there are some options to be having horizontal specialization model, semi-vertical, full vertical, or multi-sector vertical. And the question is, which one more suitable for Indonesian condition, and which one more the world becoming most competitive? Now we are trying to define that multi-sector vertical, vertically integrated value chain is the most competitive way to have to improve the efficiency and productivity to get the value-added product. Thank you for watching and listening. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you so much, Dr. Desianto, for giving us such an informative and interesting presentation. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, now we move on our presentation to the second speaker, Dr. Dedi. Is Dr. Dedi with us?
Yes.
Okay. Dr. Dedi, please proceed with your presentation in 25 minutes. Okay.
Okay, good afternoon. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
In this afternoon, I try to present title potential local raw material for fish feed. Could you listen to my voice?
Yes, sir. Yes,
we can hear your sound,
okay.
Your voice clearly.
First, let's start to see the picture here. Looking at this image taken from the state of the World Fisheries and Aquaculture from FAO, this figure shows fish production both from aquaculture and fisheries. You can see here, until 220 or 210, the figure saw the real data, while the following years is processed and projected data. We can see that since 90, yeah, fish production has stagnant, and even in the coming year, it is estimated that catch will decline. Meanwhile, aquaculture production continue to increase along with the increasing world population and change. And this also due to the change of the diet for human to obtain the healthy source of protein. On the other hand, the production of fisheries, which is fish meal and fish oil, usually used as a raw material for aquafeed, also reduced. Therefore, the decline in catch level have an effect on change in feed formulation for aquaculture. See here, in 2000, fish feed production was 14 million tons. As aquaculture production increases, the production of the diet also increased to 65 million tons projected in 2020. The decrease in feed production was accompanied by decreasing the percentage of fish meal use and also fish oil. So fish oil and fish meal previously used 20% and then reduced to 7%, you know, because the decline of the catch of the fish in the world. Here we can see that currently feed raw material are dominated by terrestrial animal protein and plant protein source. Terrestrial animal protein source consists of poultry byproduct milk, meat byproduct meals, and blood meal. While terrestrial plant consists of byproduct meal, including corn gluten or maize, wheat gluten, dyed distiller grain with soluble and with bran, and also soybean meal. We can see the producer of this material, raw material coming from US, Brazil, New Zealand, Australia, Argentina, not from South Asia. Southeast Asia country, I think. The closer one is India that produce soybean meal. So in the case of Indonesia, one or several fish producer company join to buy this material together, so they import together, so they can obtain a competitive price because they are directly obtained from the producer countries. On the other hand, small scale feed manufacturing must buy raw material from importers or third parties so that they get the higher price. The implication is that the selling price of feed made by small-scale feed manufacturing cannot compete with feed from the factory. Due to this condition, small-scale feed manufacturing make feed from local raw material. Mm-hmm. we can see here, local raw material are commonly used by small scale feed manufacturing. This is the real data from the some of Indonesian that used by the farm by the small scale feed manufacturing. Actually, animal source should be good palatability, good essential amino acid profile, and good source of omega 3 and 6 essential fatty acid. However, we find here that the animal source, for instance, they have high moisture content. You see, standard is 10%. High ash content. And if we use salty trash fish, it's also contain high salt. And we found also fish meal that high content of fiber. It should be our concern that fish should not have fiber, yeah, only from the stomach. And related to this condition, I'm very concerned with trash fish, which has been made into salt fish. As seen in the previous slide, the quality of salt fish is not good. Usually salt fish contain high total volatile base nitrogen, biogenic amine, and bacteria. This happened because the drying process is not perfect, take for a long time by sun dry. So we have an alternative challenge, opportunity to use the trash fish. Rather than use as a salted fish, we can use as a silage or hydrolyze it by using a low pH and enzymatic from the fish on. So using this silage, we can get high quality content of amino acid on or fatty acid. This silage also had a good attractant. You know, since the using of fish meal reduced, the feed reduced the attractant. The attractability is reduced. And also contain phospholipid. So this is the alternative use as of trash fish. And you know that the market of this silage is very potential, very good. Because for instance, Indonesia now imported this silage from other country. And if we can produce this, it is the challenge, opportunity to make a good business. This is one condition that I propose. The second one, local material are commonly used in small scale manufacturing from plant origin, using rice polishing, rice bran, corn meal, pumpkin meal, or copra meal. This is the commonly used plant origin in Indonesia because it's very cheap, rich source of phosphorus, and good source of vitamin E and B. However, contain high fiber. You know, in fish feed, the high content of fiber reduces the digestibility or the quality of feed and is fermented commonly under 8%. Also, high content of phytate. Fiber is a structural component of plant. Yeah. Working maximum for adult fish which are tolerant of fiber would be around 8% in the diet. While phytate is commonly found in plant seed. It present reduce the availability of mineral ions such as calcium, magnesium, etc., and in some cases, dietary protein. Phytate can be removed from the ingredient source by heat treatment or fermenting the ingredient prior to the inclusion in the diet, or by inclusion of the enzyme phytase in the feed. So quality improvement of local raw material to reduce the fiber content of plant ingredient, we can hydrolyze the cellulose by the enzyme cellulose. So cellulose by the act of enzyme will hydrolyze to be non-complex molecule, finally to be a glucose. Then the digestibility of this raw material increase. For illustration, we use Cyperman liquor enzyme that contain high content of cellulase activity, but now commercially available cellulase enzyme. So we recommend it to use this cellulase enzyme when we use the carbohydrate source. For instance, the using of cellulose will reduce the fiber content in the coconut meal, copra, from 14% to 7%. So digestibility of the diet or copra by decreasing the fiber increase, for instance, for total digestibility increase from 55 to 64%. And digestibility of protein increased from 65 to 80%. For tilapia, the same case is same. Digestibility increase. In case of palm kernel meal, yeah, we know this is planting very intensively in Indonesia, also Vietnam and other country. And the palm kernel meal, after the oil extracted, can be used as a feed ingredient. But we have to reduce the fiber content by using the cellulase from 16 to 7%. So after we reduce the fiber content, the digestibility, for instance, this is for panaceus, the digestibility increase from 30% to 55%. We have to increase this digestibility because in order to increase the efficiency of feed when we feeding on fish. The other one is reduction of phytate in plant ingredient by using phytase. You know, in grain, usually phosphorus and other mineral attached to phytate. So when we get phytase enzyme, phytase can separate phosphorus and other mineral from phytate. So if you use phytate or phytase, then we can use in the diet or we cannot use inorganic phosphorus, then replace with the carbohydrate source. So we reduce the utilization of inorganic phosphorus and some other minerals. The dose of the phytase level was found about 5 milligram per 1 gram of soybean meal. For instance, in the case of soybean meal. In other raw material also relatively the same. Only 2 hours, we can reduce the pitate in the raw material. When you use pitate as a component in feed, then we have the advantage where phosphor digestibility will increase from 73% to 86%, while the phosphor excreted via feces also we reduced from 4% of from 4 gram per kilogram of his weight to 1.7 gram. That's mean that if we use phytase, we can reduce the loading of waste to the waters, while the FCR content also decrease. Then we look for the new local raw materials for fish feed. One is cinnamon leaves. I think everyone knows in Indonesia for kayu manis. Kayu manis obtained from the bark of the cinnamon plant. When they harvest the bark, the leaf, they live in the forest and use it. So we try to use cinnamon leaf. Why? Yeah. We found that cinnamon can improve glucose utilization by increasing the glutathione 4 or mRNA expression in insulin receptor. So when high content of feed containing high carbohydrate, fish can utilize high content of carbohydrate in their body. This cinnamon also used in human for people who get the diabetes to reduce the glucose content in the blood. And cinnamon stimulate fatty acid oxidation in adipose tissue. So this cinnamon leaf can regulate the carbohydrate or fat in the diet, so more efficient to use as an energy rather than they put in the adipose as a energy source, energy. Yeah. So it is can be used as a feed additive. We first try with pangasius. Yeah. Actually, cultivating pangasius by using food containing low protein, high carbohydrate, when we harvest, the fish had low quality of meat, characterized by a high lipid content, mushy. Not only pangasius, when we export the fish, for instance, tilapia, eel, and also actually a shrimp, high quality of the meat should be required to be exported. This is the characteristic low lipid content, not mushy on no earthy flavor. Should be our concern. And this also related to the consumer need for the high quality aquaculture product. So as we talked in the first slide, that the utilization of fish meal and fish oil reduced, while then we use more plant animal source, terrestrial plant and animal source, that also especially in plant source, high content of carbohydrate. It means that fish harvested from aquaculture usually high lipid content in the meat. Then we try to use it. So we have an experiment. Pangasius with body weight of 300 gram were fed on the diet by using cinnamon or not cinnamon. After 2 months feeding period, control only 554 gram, while if we add cinnamon in the diet, feeding on cinnamon increasing the body weight of fish, almost 100 gram difference. It means that when we add cinnamon, harvest period or culture period will be reduced to get to obtain the same fish size. Then production efficiency will be increased. For instance, normally they culture in 6 month period for Pangasius. When we use cinnamon, the production period reduced to 5 months. The other one is lipid and protein content in Pangasius meat after culture for 2 months. So we can see the lipid content reduce almost half from the control diet, while protein, because lipid reduce the protein control content also increase. This means that fish or meat of fish more good quality, because you know in the case of Pangasius, when the lipid content high, we cannot use as a fillet. Yeah. And then the appearance of the meat, the color of meat without cinnamon, reddish. It is not suitable for export. While when we use cinnamon, become white. So cinnamon changed the color of the meat of Pangasius from red to white. High lipid content for the cinnamon, mushy also, and of flavor earthy. While the meat of fish feeding on cinnamon, no mushy or of flavor earthy we found. So,
I'm sorry, Dr. Dedi, your time is 5 minutes left.
Okay, that situation, and then the this application we already used to eel tilapia for export. This the last challenge, I think, to the opportunity to have a business with cinnamon. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for your great presentation, Dr. Dedi. Now we move on to our last presentation that will be delivered by the by our third speaker, Dr. Marcel. Hello, Dr. Marcel.
Hi, Dr. How are you?
Okay, doctor, you can proceed with your presentation, please.
Okay, I will share my screen. First of all, I would like to say thank you to SVIPB for inviting me on this webinar, and it is a great honor for me to be a speaker among the great teacher in this webinar. So it's an honor for me. Okay, wait a second. Can you all see my screen?
Yes, we can see clear.
Okay, I will start the presentation. So we will talk about creating innovation of the veterinary industry, specifically in pet animal industry. But I will touch a little about the livestock industry. In this new normal era, which is driven by the pandemic, obviously. And before we talk about the current situation, I will explain about the MSD animal health history. So basically, we've been around in the world since 1940s. And MSD established as animal health division and discovered the sulfaquinoxalin, which is the first poultry coccidiostat. And in 1955, we published the Merck Veterinary Manual. As you may know, this is mostly the main literature back in the days if we want to write a script or a thesis. And in 1997, MSD and French pharmaceutical company called Ron Merix, or later called Sanofi, combined their animal health division in an equal-owned joint venture named Merial. So if you know Merial, right now is acquired by the Boehringer Ingelheim. And in 2007, Schering-Plough acquired Organon Bioscience, and which is Intervet and Organon from AkzoNobel. And the animals, which is the animal health division, operate as Intervet Schering-Plough Animal Health. So basically, Intervet was enter Indonesian market first in back in 90s. And after Schering-Plough acquired, then we stopped there. But after that, in 2009, Merck and Co. acquired Schering-Plough Intervet. So right now, the name is MSD Animal Health. But currently in Indonesia, we're still using the legal name of PT Intervet Indonesia. And in 2011, we operate under the name of Merck's Animal Health in US and Canada, and MSD Animal Health outside US and Canada. So that's the brief history of MSD Animal Health. Now we talk about our current situation in Southeast Asia market. Right now, we are the most prolific emerging market in here because we have a great population of people. Indonesia is the highest population in Southeast Asia, and following by Philippines and Vietnam. But in terms of the GDP, Singapore is number one. And for Indonesia specifically, is only around 3.9 thousand USD per capita. So it's around 4.7 million rupiah per month, which is mostly like the minimum wage average in for people in Indonesia. But this is only the data from 2020. If you see the graphic from IMF data, we will grow exponents quite okay after 2020. And hopefully we can handle this pandemic quite soon. And after we know about the GDP of Indonesia and the population in Indonesia, we need to talk about the Indonesia digital economy potential. As stated on CNBC Indonesia per December 19, 2020, we have the growth of online purchasing in Indonesia 40%, and the internet user is 93.4 million people and 71 million for smartphone user. So basically the internet user is around 33% of the population, and the smartphone user is around 22% of the population in Indonesia. So it's quite big. And after we talk about that, we also need to see how the Indonesia e-commerce market. I get this data from iPrice. This is the data of quarter 1, 2021, which is the monthly web visitor of each top five e-commerce in Indonesia. As you can see, Tokopedia leading the market. They have around 135 million visitors per month. And following in second place is Shopee. And as you can see, when Tokopedia merges with Gojek, it will become the most anticipated merger in 2021, because it's gonna be they will support the 2% of the GDP in Indonesia. So it's gonna be so big, and it will drive the economy of digital in Indonesia much further in the future. And also our president, Mr. Jokowi, said that in 2025, the digital economy will reach around $133 billion. Right now in 2020, we just have the number around $21 billion. So it's gonna be a big thing for us in Indonesia. So better to start to present our company online, or our brand online, because in the future it's gonna be significant impact for us. And how about the Indonesia companion animal market? Based on Royal Canin survey in 2018, we have pet population, which is mostly dogs and cats, around 24.9 million pets. And more than 1,000 small animal pets practice in Indonesia. And based on thesis from Dr. Putri Sayuti from the journal in 2018, the average pet cost of dogs is around 10.1 million rupiah per year. And the dog population is around 3.3 million. But the medicated one is only 1.65 million. And the cats is they have more population than dog, which is 21.6 million, the total cat population, based on Royal Canin data. But the medicated one, which is basically the cat, the pet owner brings the cat or the dogs to the vets to get the annual medication or annual checkup, is only around 4.3 million. And the average pet cost of cats is only around 4.7 million rupiah per year. So this is our potential market for pet animal industry. That's why a lot of international company willing to invest more to get the market share of this pet industry in Indonesia. So moving on, I was able to join the veterinary update that was held by the Grupo Asis from Spain. On the webinar, the president of World Veterinary Association, Dr. Rafael Leguens, said that the pandemic left billions of people isolated in home, and many turns to pet for companionship. So if you may notice in this past year, mental health is also trending in some of the area. And somehow in US, a lot of shelter of pet shown an increase of the pet adoption. So apparently the companionship of pets is one of the several solution for people to adapt to the new normal. They need some companionship that willing to love them back without any condition, and that's such a wonderful story to if you read about this in the internet. And globally, nearly 3 out of 4 of pet owners describe their pets as a beloved member of the family. So it's not about the pets anymore. Somehow they say the pet is the family member. So it's not the pet anymore. And pet owners currently more discerning about their pets, focusing on functional and safe choice. So they are willing to sacrifice their luxury vacation, their luxury items to be able to spend more in pets. So that's what the trendings right now on the pandemic. And about the vet clinic. Vet clinic corporations, as Dr. Rafael said in the presentation back then, a lot of veterinary is still independent or privately owned practice. But if you see in the UK, 48% of the vet practice is a corporate practice, which is have a division of HR, division of marketing, and division of paramedics, and division of vet. So it's more corporate, and it is more specific in terms of the job desk. But if you see globally, it's just around 20%, the corporate practice. But we can see the trend, the corporate practice is still increasing. Like in the US, some corporate own like around 800 clinics around US. And in UK in 2018, UK, based on the data, around 13,000 vets was working in the corporate practice. So it will become increase and will be a trend, an increasing trend start from now. And Dr. Rafael Aguirre's associate on the presentation about the shaping of the future of livestock. Basically, the main driver is the population growth, like Dr. Desi said, and the GDP growth also the driver. When you have more money, you will need more to spending on the meat or the luxurious brand or maybe on pets. And the urbanization and also the globalization, that driver leading to the more demand of animal source product, source food, especially in low and middle income countries. And the outcome is increase the production. That's why we are here to help the producer to be more efficiently in the producing the meat. And also they need the structural change in the livestock sector, like the change from the open house cages to the indoor cages for poultry, like example, and more movement and trade in livestock and production. And also the concern for the livestock is the sustainability. How is the food security, the livelihood, the animal health and animal welfare, and the research, and also the climate change and the environment. And to give support to all the global producer, we, MSD Animal Health, have several manufacturing sites around the world. So basically, if you see the blue one is the biological manufacture, so mostly vaccine or hormone. And if you see the pharmaceutical is on the green, such as Bravecto or Optimune for the cyclosporin treatment, and another pharmaceutical. But in Indonesia, we just imported the product from Boxmeer, which is from Netherlands. And Boxmeer located near in Netherlands, near the border of Germany. And Boxmeer facility is the most biggest animal health manufacturing site. And there's also our R&D division work around 1,030 employee work there. And this is our manufacturing site in Boxmeer, Netherlands. And in Indonesia, for the companion animal, we only have the vaccine portfolio, which is under the brand of Nobivac. If you know Nobivac Tricatrio, Nobivac DHPPI, and we distribute to more than 110 countries in the world, and we distribute vaccines. So, our main product, which is Bravecto, we sold around 125 million doses around the world to 85 countries. And this is the most prolific product right now, which is because we have the new ingredients for anti-ectoparasite, which is fluralaner. And now, after we know the current situation, current market, where are we going? Oh, MSD acquire Antelic. And Antelic is an umbrella of Alflex, Biomark, and Paki, and also Sure Pet Care. If you know, the Alflex is most ear tech, and Biomark usually was used for the conservation to identify the movement of specific animal like turtle or fish in the ocean. And Faki is a producer and have a lot of microchip for pets and a smart bowl and smart wearable. And all of that acquired by MSD into. And right now in 2021, all Antelic umbrella was branded under the new name, which is MSD Animal Health Intelligence. So if you see the company around the world trying to move to create them on digital. So they tried not only MSD, they also buy a digital company such as Antelic to create a system one-stop services to maintain the relationship with the customer, to give good services to the customer, to make the producer to be more efficient. And that's why MSD Animal Health Intelligence was established. During this pandemic, we cannot visit the customer as usual. So that's why we did marketing such as and work closely with Google. And it is quite interesting to find that Google show that normally before the digital, some of the pet owner conversation talk about the food that they use and which product that they will need to buy. And sometimes they purchase of the pet product because of they run off products that they that they use. And some people saw the TV commercial about the food products, and then some people read the newspaper, magazine to decide which product of food or veterinary product that they will use. But right now, the digital marketing is available. The 12% were online and came across an article or blog or post about a pet food. And 9% saw an ad social media about the pet food products. And some others also view the online video or online banner about the pet food. 4% just search about the pet food that they want to buy. So basically right now, if we use digital marketing, we know exactly what market that we want to target. We know how the market react about the about our ads, the ads, and it's reflected on the numbers, so we can have a analysis about the market situation. If we use digital on the digital marketing right now, and it's not because the pandemic that we started the digital marketing initiation, but we developed this late starting in 2015, and the pandemic just drive us more faster to transform our business. So this is quite interesting for me because I don't have any background of this of the digital marketing before, because I was graduated as a vet, but now I have to learn about these things. And I urge the student in Sekolah Vokasi to learn also about these things, because this is quite interesting, and it is not only can be used for the brand or the company, but it can only use to branding yourself. Like some vets have a podcast, some vets have try to sell a scrub or something like that, and it can be useful if you know how to use the digital marketing. And currently, the online consultation is also available for the vets. And Halodoc is also provide the services. As you can see on the web of Halodoc, you can try to chat a veterinarian. And as far as I know, percentage fee based on the consultation per patient. And this is quite common in the US, because during this pandemic, the online consultation is the have major growth in US to make the clinic survive the pandemic. And also the technology, this is basically what the SurePet with the microchip. They have a flap connected that can be installed on the door, so only a microchip user cat or dog can enter the flap door. Or the microchip pet feeder connect, so on install with the microchip can eat from that smart bowl. And also the water smart bowl from SurePet. So basically this is to monitor the dog, the water consumption, and then the food consumption of its pets. And also SurePet have the wearable device like Animo. This is basically like Fitbit, like Mi Band, that can monitor the heart rate of the pets, and it can give you the data analysis more comprehensive. So each time you visit the vet can directly know how your pet is going. Is it healthy, or is it have a disease that need to be treated or not? And as I said before, we try to build the ecosystem. So with the with the smart pad, door, smart bowl, we try to collect the data and give the vet a comprehensive data about the specific pets of the client. So it will help the veterinarian more easily to identify the disease from the cats and to do the and about the digital tech market specifically. If we see right now in 2025, we predicted that telemedicine plus telehealth will have a lot of sales around $140 million, and the reminder application $170 million. This is basically a reminder like if your pet have to be vaccinated or have to be treated with a regular ectoparasiticide, you will have a reminder on your smartphone. And the wearables that I said before, tracker the health status of your pet, and the platform of marketplace will have a lot of growth during in the future. So this is basically what the company aiming for, an ecosystem of digital to give a great services to the vets, to the meat product producer and around the world. And if I may touch a little bit about the future of livestock, currently MSD Animal Health Intelligence already acquired IdentiGen. So basically, in the future, if we want to have a meal, specifically a steak, maybe you can. You can ask the chef which grade of meat that you want, because right now we have a wearable device in that can by the livestock to identify the rumination, to identify the medical history, the vaccination that they get, the medical treatment that they get, the antibiotic that they give to the cattle or to the sheep, and then they will the all the data will be recorded. And on the fork, as I said before, you can choose which meat quality that you want to have as your dinner or as your lunch. So it is getting more interested in the future how the livestock industry also. And because of the pandemic, as I said before, we cannot visit the pet owner, we cannot visit the vets as usual. That's why we develop more on the webinar. And for example, this is a pet festival that was held in this year on the quarter one. They create an expo virtually. We have a booth here. So in the booth, you can go inside the booth, and then there is a button to click to chat directly to the WhatsApp of admin. You can click a booth to access a website, and you can click a booth to access the e-commerce. With this expo, the organizer try to increase the purchasing of the product by the digital marketing. And we also have a pet seminar of the launching product, because we cannot do right now. Usually we do that in the hotel or the seminar room, but right now it can only happen in the webinar. And the last one is about the website. So right now people keep asking about, should I create website or should I create a social media agency? So it depends on your product. If you want to create a website, you can maximize the algorithm of the Google. So basically it's called SEO, search engine optimization. So if you have a good design of the website, you have a good sentences on the website, you choose the words specifically to maximize the SEO, you can get notified by the people who search your product. So let's say you type Bravecto Indonesia, and then if your SEO of your website is good, so your website domain will automatically on the first line of the Google search. So, and also if you use website, you can also do the e-commerce or provide your services. Like if you have a product that can be buy the customer online, then you have that quite deal with that services. And when to use the social media. So basically, social media is when you want to engage more with the customer, because you can post content and then the customer can write a comment and you can reply the comment. So basically, it's an interaction between you and your potential customer. And also, you can create an engagement with them through social media. But once again, if you want them to buy your product or to find a legit information about your product, then you need a website, because the website will provide a legit and formal product knowledge, a formal knowledge of your services. So that's the difference of the website and the social media. So it's back to you again, which one you want to choose. So to sum up to sum up my presentation, in the future, we will see more demanding pet owners, of course, because the information was you can find the information about your pet, about the disease online. So that's why we as a vet have to continue learning about the diseases and how to consult and do the client education to our client. And there will be more corporate clinics or corporate chains of the clinics in the future. So let's think about it again. And think that they know best. So right now, a lot of veterinarians have the business let's say they just provide the vaccine, but they don't improve their skill on how to use the USG or how to use the X-ray. So I think it is better for us to improve our skill on that and invest more on the technology like USG, X-ray, and then the hematology, because if we have that technology in our clinic, it will create more demand and also create more market for us also. So you cannot only maintain the vaccination or maintain the cesarean or the surgery or the minor surgery. So you have to improve your skill in order to sustain your pet clinics if you have one in the future, hopefully. So I think that's all to sum up my presentation. Hopefully it will help you to open the mind. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Marcel, for the great presentation. Okay. We still have time. Now we move on to the discussion session. For anybody who have question, you can write on the column chat, or you can use the icon raise hand and ask the speaker directly. Okay, I guess we have one question. First of all, I want to thank all the speakers for the fantastic presentation. I want to ask Mr. Desianto about the genetically changed chicks. Is the Pocton company still breed the parents of the selected chicks, or just focusing on the selected cheeks. Thank you. By Muhammad Fatir. Dr. Desianto, you can answer the question.
Sorry, what was the question is?
About genetically changed chick. Is the Potpun company still breed the parents of the selected chicks or just focusing on the selected chicks?
We are not applying any selection in the commercial level for both great parent stock as well as final stock. To all the selection program is being held by the pure line companies, breeding companies. Nowadays only 2 or 3 big companies available in the world doing the selection to continue doing the selection and breeding program in the pure line level, not in the GP, not in the PS, not in the FS. We are only growing the commercial one for FS, PS, and as well as GP. So in terms of selection program and breeding program, we are not applying anything during the selection program in the commercial life level. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Desianto. Okay, we have another question from Mr. Wiyoto. Thank you so much, Pak Dr. Dedi Jusadi, for giving such an informative and interesting presentation. In your opinion, what local raw materials are the most ready to be commercialized? Is there any local raw materials that it's ready to be commercialized, Dr. Dedi? You still on mute? Okay.
Depend on the people or us how to use the potential for business. For instance, cinnamon leaves is already ready, but I'm going to look around the cinnamon producer area such as West Sumatra and also Jambi. I talk to local people, but maybe because I met with the, how can I say, just the not businessmen, so it is difficult to encourage them to utilize this cinnamon leaf. But I think it's already easy to use because we just need to oven it, drying, and then make it a flour, and then directly use to the feed. In feed formulation or in feed that already, for instance, in commercial feed available. Yeah. So far, I use demonstrated this cinnamon leaf to the farmer in many areas, and especially they use only 2 weeks prior to the harvest because they fish want to sell to export, I mean going to the cold storage, and the cold storage need the high quality of the meat of fish as well, pangasius, tilapia, or eel. It is easy to use, actually. Okay.
Okay. Pak Wiyoto? Is there anything you want to ask, Pak Wiyoto?
Okay, thank you, he said.
Okay. Thank you. We have another question for Dr. Marcel, how should vaccination, deworming, and flea control programs be structured to keep pets healthy during the pandemic?
Hello.
Yep.
So right now, the vaccination can still perform only by the vets. So right now, because of the PPKM, some of the clinic can still open because they are in the essential business, but they reduce the operating time. Usually, if they used to be open until 10, they now open until only 5 p.m. or 6 p.m. And so basically, you can still visit the clinics, but you have to make an appointment first. And some clinic provide the strict regulation of the protocol of COVID. So sometimes they only allow one client and one pet to enter the clinic, and that's why you can get the vaccination and the deworming program. Or some clinic also open, but they only give an online consultation. So after the consultation, they will give you a prescription that can be that you can buy from their own apothec. So I think that's how you maintain the vaccination and the deworming regulation during this pandemic.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Marcel. Okay, we have another question to Dr. Dedi from Andri Iskandar. Thank you, Pak Dedi, for your clear presentation. As you mentioned earlier, and as we know that Indonesia has a lot of raw local material, but to make this local material source more efficient and effective, we need to improve the source with add more treatment. So then the feed source has a good quality. Compared to the commercial feed, which now dominates Indonesian aquaculture, which is most of the feed source came from overseas, what is your opinion, the strategy to push the government to support our raw local material so it can use totally on Indonesian fish feed production in the future?
Good question. Maybe recently 90% of raw material is imported. Yeah, they are imported from abroad. And our source recently only limited, such as I presented, only palm kernel milk and also rice bran, for instance. The others almost limited. In the future, I think Indonesia has made another strategy to fulfill the raw material needed for fish feed. I think we have to culture the raw material for aquaculture, but the situation is, for instance, in my opinion, we have to culture the organism that culture in the pollutant area. The harvested organism that culture in pollutant area not suitable for human consumption. Then we use as feed ingredient. For instance, is ulva, the kind of macroalgae that can grow very fast and consume organic and in organic material, and also shell that absorb also organic material. For macroalgae, the anorganic material that contain pollution. So if we culture the two kind of this organism, we can clean the environment. You know that the increasing of industrial in Indonesia also increasing the waste in the marine area. So if we culture this species or this organism, we can harvest for feed purpose, and the other we can clean the waters. I think that the strategy, but it needs for a long period and also need from government wisdom, yeah, to realize this this opinion. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Dedi. Okay, oh, we still have a lot of question here. Okay, the next one is from Nurul Mashita to Dr. Dedi, I believe. Feed production and formulation has related to fish behavior. Recommended aquaculture feeding strategies are needed to be a special formula for freshwater and seawater fish. What is the right strategy in making feed formulas from the materials that contain plant-based raw materials, in example, like cassava leaves, cinnamon leaves, and so on?
Yeah, the formulation is different, of course, from species to species. But if we have a lot of carbohydrate source, so we need to culture freshwater fish. That's because mainly omnivorous fish that can receive more carbohydrate in the formula or in the diet. While for mariculture, recently we culture only carnivorous fish. Maybe in the future, we need to change the character of marine fish. For instance, we have also to culture baronang. What is baronang? Siganus, yeah, the kind of species that herbivorous fish. So if we use omnivorous or herbivorous fish, so the dependent for fish meal will be reduced, because we can culture omnivorous fish for the feed with low protein content and high carbohydrate. While for marine carnivorous fish, we need high protein and high lipid content rather than omnivorous fish. That's the strategy. I think we can see the data for aquaculture in China. They culture almost all species that they have a different trophic level to utilize more niche in the waters. So the China more efficient in produce aquaculture product than us or other country, I think. That's the strategy. I hope that can answer the question.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Dedi. Mrs. Nurul Mashita? Is there anything you would like to ask? Or is it enough?
Bilang ayo ning tias raising.
Okay. I will move to Mrs. Gilang Ayuning Tias first, and then we continue to the next question that come to my chat. Please, Mrs. Gilang.
Thank you, Dr. Heryu, for the opportunities. And also thank you to all the speakers for the wonderful presentation and also the topics. I want to ask Mr. Desianto. Hello, Pak Desianto. In your presentation, you said about the challenges for the future because there are trends, the kind of people like vegan and also animal welfareists, right? And my question is, what is your opinion about the cultivated meats related to the halal issue? Because as we know, Indonesia almost the people almost Muslim, and also what is your opinion as the poultry meat producer Charon Pokpan Indonesia to answer these challenges, the type of the consumers, because I think the poultry meats have a specification for the nutritional content, like the type of fatty acid. I think if we use the plant source for the meat, artificial meat, it cannot replace the type of the fatty acid that contain in the broiler meat. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. First of all, for the concern regarding the halal issue, it's quite correct because the meat, the cultured meat or artificial meat is not really coming from the animal slaughter using Bismillah or whatsoever. So it's still big question mark whether this is halal or not halal. We do not have the answer yet, but becoming the big concern of us that we are not opposing the cultured meat whatsoever, but we have to have the food available for us has to be asuh, aman, sehat, utuh, halal. Clearly, will sound safe and halal. So for that issue, we are not really sure whether this is included to the halal or not halal, but we are going to propose this is to bring this issue to the Majelis Ulama and asking what their opinion regarding this, the artificial or culture meat. And secondly, regarding the cost, now it's still not being competitive enough to replace the in terms of economic price. It's not really competitive compared with the ordinary or conventional meat, the real meat from chicken or from ruminant. So it's only big question mark whether it will be socially available for the whole society or maybe just for the very rich people can afford with almost million rupiah per kg of the cultured meat. So in terms of price, in terms of the halal issue, in terms of the social acceptability, this is becoming the homework for those society who are running the issue. And but don't forget, they are supported by big people from big companies in the United States. And also we are being supported by the animal welfareists as well as the environmentalists, because no cruelty to the animal and also not polluting to the environment. Just for the time being that I can answer this question. Thank you.
Thank you, Pak Desianto.
You're welcome.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Gilang. And then we move on to the next question from Tera Fitrayani to Dr. Desianto. Moving from an open house cage to a closed house cage will require a very high cost. If there is no big cost to replace the cage, what things must be done or considered so that the open house can still produce good productivity?
Because the chicken has been already highly selected under temperate, quote unquote, temperate condition. So mostly chicken rear under open-sided housing system suffer from the heat stress condition. So heat stress condition is not good for the face of the finisher or grower type, but it's good for the young chick until 10 days of age. But for the grower and finisher phase, they still need more comfortable being having temperature below than 26 degrees Celsius. This is very, very difficult unless we are having the chicken house under the high altitude or in the hilly or mountainous area. So mostly for the adult chicken, food for broiler and layer, they are suffering the heat stress condition. That's why if you are noticing that my comparison between open and closed house performance is really big difference. Not only the body weight different, but 400 grams, but also the FCR, the feed conversion ratio. In under closed house, only 1.4, and the open house, 1.7, 1.8. So 40 different score point for the FCR, speak a lot of money difference. Indeed, the disadvantages of the building closed house is required big capital of money. So for those who are not able to pay or getting the loan from the bank, it's very difficult to have the closed house for their operation. So to answer your question, how do we improve the performance under open-sided housing system? We can still having the positive what you call it, not negative pressure, but positive pressure of the fan to move out the dirty air in the chicken house open-sided to get out from the other side. Excuse me. So, but still under limitation for the open-sided housing system compared to the closed house. That's my answer. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Desi. Mrs. Tera, is there anything you would like to ask? Okay. Okay, move on to the next question from Ivan Taufik Nugraha to Dr. Dedi. I have a question for Mr. Dedi. I have a database problem about the waste fish in Indonesia. Where the waste fish after the consumption? Because he is working with the waste of istongko for increasing the appetite of pet animal. And his big question is, who take the advantage of waste fish, or is it just thrown to the environment?
Okay. Waste from the fish processing plant, I think, usually including the viscera, yeah, and other part, we can make a fish hydrolyze by using by lowering the pH of the waste, then their enzymes will work to hydrolyze the waste or the rest of the fish. Then it is become a good source as a raw material, since it can be increasing at least the palatability of feed you know, since fish searching the diet by using chemoreception, high content of fish hydrolyzed or not high, only 5%, no more than 5%, then the fish, the fish become attractable, the feed become attractable to the fish. So far I know, we import the fish hydrolyzed from other country that's made from the waste of tuna processing plant. Tuna processing plant, they make fish hydrolyzed, then they export to Indonesia and then we use it. So why we do not use it if you have a lot of processing plant, if you have processing plant? Yeah, easy to do. Very easy.
And is it's the a good source that, of raw material. We hydrolyze? Sorry, Dr. Dini.
Yeah.
Is
yeah.
it the fissure you know, that we all of hydrolyze? The rest,
all of the rest of waste, we can use it.
Hydrolyze. Okay. Yeah, we in pet animal, we always use a hydrolyzed protein for our animal companion feed, like cat and dog, always use the hydrolyzed protein.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Dedi.
You're welcome.
The next one is from Anis Kusairia to Dr. Marcel. I want to ask Mr. Marcel, as we know nowadays, e-commerce is getting more and more administrative costs. So the price of the product or services become expensive. Do you think Indonesian people will move completely to e-commerce? Thank you. You are still muted. Dr. Marcel. You're still mute, Dr. Marcel? Host, is it possible to unmute Dr. Marcel, please?
Hello?
Okay.
Sip. Oh, yeah. Sorry. I was signed out back then.
Okay.
Yeah, so first of all the veterinary medicine products, especially vaccine and pharmaceutical product, should be registered in the Kementan first, enable to market it in Indonesia. And not all of the animal health product can be sell through e-commerce channel. For example, like Bravecto. Bravecto got the license from the Kementan, which is obat keras. So it should be prescribed by the vet. So if we get the certification like that, so we cannot sell directly to the e-commerce. But if the certification is not stated that way, for example, like the warmer product that is available in the e-commerce, and even some of the company have a official e-commerce account in Tokopedia or Shopee, it is still possible as long as the certification is not prescribed. And how to maintain the price right now? If we see on the market, if the people have the if the company have the official account in e-commerce, they will put the highest price on the e-commerce. So if they have a reseller, they will have to sell below that official price on the e-commerce. So that will maintain the price for the and that will maintain the price and that will maintain the revenue of the reseller if they want to go through e-commerce. So I think that's how to maintain the price.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Marcel. for the audience is we will have a 5-minute break for Azan. So we'll be back in 5 minutes. So if you want to have a drink or stretching, you are pleased to. We will have a 5 minute break. Okay. Okay, we're back again. Thank you for the wait. I hope you all got the refreshment from our break session. Okay, we still have a lot of time. So audience, if you still want to ask, you can write in the chat room or you can raise a hand that you can click in the bottom part of your screen in the reaction. Okay, now we move on to the next question that will delivered directly by Mrs. Dian. Dian Eka Ramadhani. I would like to invite Mrs. Dian Eka to deliver the questions.
She need to open the mic.
Mrs. Dian? Host, can you unmute?
Yeah, thank you. Okay, thank you, Dr. Heriu. And thank you for the opportunity given to me. And sorry, unfortunately, I can't open my camera because there is an unstable connection problem in my area and it's currently cloudy. It's going to rain. I'm so sorry. And thanks for the speakers who are very extraordinary. And today we get a lot of knowledge. And this is very, very complete. And there is a husbandry, fisheries, and veterinary. That's wonderful. Actually, my question is for Dr. Dedi. Yeah, Dr. Dedi is my lecturer when I studied at Department of Aquaculture, actually, and I'm very, very happy to meet you again in this webinar. But I'm sorry, I cannot open my camera, doctor. Okay. And if we think about the fish meal and fish oil are of superior ingredients for fish nutrition, plant-based raw materials have replaced them in major amounts, but specific means are needed to fulfill nutritional requirements of fish, right? And my question is, in the village, there are the traditional farmers who use the plant-based raw materials like a cassava leaves and then papaya leaves, banana tree trunk, and so on. And they use it directly to the fish without processing, actually, sir. Like a boiling, drying, or put the plant-based raw material into the pellet or with the extract, they didn't do that. And someday, their activities often produce good results. But on the other hand, when the rainy season arrives, the fish suddenly die in the mass. And therefore, what should we recommend for them? Because to be honest, it is rather difficult to give a recommendation. And what kind of the approach can we take to them? Yeah, the approachment, I think.
Yeah. When you use the plant ingredient as raw material, many of plant ingredients such as cassava leaves contain anti-nutrient factors.
Yes.
So of course we cannot use directly as feed ingredient in this way directly to the formulation. We need to process it before we use as a feed ingredient, such as heating. For instance, cassava leaves contain high amount of cyanide. Cyanide is, you know, very harmful for fish. And others plant ingredient, of course, containing different anti-nutrient. So my recommendation is, first, we have to process it. Otherwise, if it is in the rainy season, we change the formulation, less using less ingredient that contain anti-nutrient that directly harm for the fish health or fish life. That's the my concern. For instance, don't use the cassava without any treatment.
Yeah,
cassava leaf. Yeah.
Yeah.
If you use it otherwise, the fish will die. The mortality will increase. Yeah, there are only we have to concern about the anti-nutrient.
So we need to educate them to make the process before we use it to for the fish, right? And I have the second question, sir.
Yeah.
Actually, is there a lot of raw material in industry that comes from local materials? Actually, original from Indonesia. There is, mass production for industry. Is there any raw material, sir?
So far, the abundant raw material so far I know is rice bran, palm kernel meal, it's so far I know. Sometime from the industrial for instant noodle. They use it because when for human is expired today, for instance,
yeah,
then we can use until 1 week.
Oh my god. So
then we have concern with the fungi.
Fungi, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We have reduced it.
Okay, thank you. And then for the herbal materials, is there any products from herbal?
Herbal.
Yep.
Yeah, use in fish, feed. But the content or the percentage of or the use of this herbal only a small amount, not much. Yeah, only maybe less than 1% it used. Yeah. Otherwise, also it is not good for fish health.
Okay, that's small, but it's usable for fish, right, sir?
Yeah, some, for instance, I explained about the cinnamon leaf.
Yeah.
We only use 1%, but affected the metabolism of carbohydrate in the fish, then the quality of meat become much more better.
Okay.
For instance.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Dedi.
Yeah.
That's wonderful. Thank you so
You're
much.
Welcome.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Haryu.
Thank you, Mrs. Dian. Okay, the next, I would like to invite Mrs. Lisa Firhani to deliver the question directly. Hello, Mrs. Lisa. Can you deliver the question? Okay. Yeah, I will read the question then. Thank you very much, speaker, for a very awesome presentation. I would like to ask Dr. Marcel. The question is relates to pets as therapy for mental health problems. What are the tips that can be given related to pet health that need to be considered for people who have never kept a pet before?
Okay, that's a tough question. So, eventually we want to pet our new first pet. It's best to ask the veterinarian because that's how we can get a legit information about how to maintain the health status of the cat or the dogs and how to manage their daily life. So during this pandemic, a lot of veterinarian around the world, especially in Indonesia also, a lot of people rescue a stray cat. So a lot of, and also a lot of veterinarian face the new customer that own a cat for the first time. So basically, all the veterinarian always said how to do the vaccination program for the cats and for the dogs, and then the dewormer is a must, and also the ectoparasiticide also is a must. So that is the three basic things that need to be learned by the pet owner, because from that three treatment, or he can say that, can affect a lot of the health of the pet that you own. So I think that's how for the health perspective for the pet owner, for the new pet owner.
Thank you, Dr. Marcel. I believe a common knowledge of pet animal husbandry is something that the owner have to know. Yeah, okay.
Yes, correct.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And also, you can have a consultation to a vet if you would like to have a pet for the first time.
Correct.
Or you can ask someone that is experienced. I believe that's the easiest way. Okay. Yes. Thank you, Dr. Marcel. Okay, is there any question for our lovely speakers today? From the students, maybe? Today we are having a great lecture from our lovely speakers, from Dr. Desianto, Dr. Dedi, and Dr. Marcel. Is there any question? Maybe student from abroad want to ask something? We have a student from abroad, from Philippines. Oh, they're also from Vietnam. We have students from Philippines and Vietnam. I'm still searching for the student. Is there anything you would like to ask student from Philippines and Vietnam? Clarissa Kenway? Are you there, Clarissa Kenway?
Hello, sir. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. How are you, Clarissa?
I'm good.
Can you tell us about what you have achieved from our lecture today? Or is there something you would like to ask? Hello, Clarissa.
I'm still processing, sir, my question.
Sorry? Can you repeat again, Clarissa?
I'm still processing my questions.
Okay. We move on to... hold on. Hello, Marcelo. Marcelo, Yabes. Hello. Okay. Well, we move on to Michelle Joy Valenzuela. Hello, Michelle Joy. Hello, Michelle Joy. Are you there, Michelle Joy? Hi, hello.
Hello, sir. I'm sorry, my connection is not stable.
Can you share with us what did you get from our lecture today?
To be honest, sir, I am having a hard time with my internet connection. So since the class has started, I'm having trouble to in and out in the Zoom meeting. So I would like to ask if is it okay for me to have a copy of this lecture? I'm so sorry, sir.
Okay, I believe the committee will give the material of our lecture today. It's very unfortunate for you to have a bad signal.
I'm so sorry, sir.
You can follow. Yeah, I hope you can still follow us, yeah?
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Sorry. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Okay, is there anyone? Nguyen. Nguyen Bin. Are you there? I'm sorry if I pronounce it incorrectly.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. So do you have any trouble following our lecture today?
I have no question.
You don't have any questions. So actually you don't have any difficulties in following our lecture, yeah? Okay. So I guess because we ran out of questions from audience, So we move on to our next session. I would like to have a closing statement from each one of the speakers. And we will start from Dr. Desi. Will you give your closing statement for today's lecture? You're still on mute, Dr. Desi, host. Please, yeah. Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Heryu, Dr. Teddy, and Dr. Marcel. Thank you for meeting you virtually. And for my closing statement in terms of the poultry industry, still have a big opportunity to develop, to progress, because even poultry meat and egg, chicken egg still the major source of animal protein, but the consumption of the people in this country still much lower compared to Malaysia. Malaysia consuming about 43 kg per capita per annum. In the meantime, Indonesian people still keep consuming about 12.5 before the pandemic. Even the BPS, the Statistical Bureau, mentioning during the pandemic, it dropped to become 8.75. So much, much lower. It means that the opportunity to grow up for the industry of poultry still remain there. And secondly, the issue of the culture meat or artificial meat will be affecting in the coming future, but not will be in very soon era will be coming to Indonesia because there are a lot of social issue, including halal issue. This may be still remain big question mark. Thank you. And thank you, Dr. Ryu, for making this webinar happened to us. Thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam. Thank you so much for your great closing statement, Dr. Desi. Okay, we now move on to closing statement from Dr. Dedi, please.
First of all, I would like to thanks to the I always thought diploma for the opportunity and invitation for me to involve in this seminar. And to all audience, thank you also for your attention and stay healthy. Take care for all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Dedi, for the closing statement. Okay, next we move on to closing statement from Dr. Marcel.
Okay. Thank you so much once again to the Committee of SBIPB, for the moderator, Dr. Harry Yu, Dr. Desi, and Dr. Dedi. It is an honor for me once again to be the speaker among all of you. And also, I would like to urge all the students to start to use the social media account. Maybe start from now, you can start creating the social media account for the business. So you can start earlier. So after you graduate, you can maybe start a digital business in the future, because digital is our future. So as soon you start, as soon you get the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Marcel, for the closing statement. Okay, now I will read, I will make some resume from the three speakers. First, for the Dr. Desianto, the global demand and production of livestock products are increasing rapidly due to the population growth, rising income, and changes in lifestyle and diets. At the same time, livestock systems have a significant impact on the environment, including air, land, soil, water, and biodiversity. The continuous growth and transformation of the livestock sector offers substantial opportunities for agriculture development, poverty reduction, food security gains, and improved human nutrition. Recently, broiler breeders use modern technology to improve productivity significantly, name the closed house system. Closed house system has several advantages, such as number of chicken density, more efficient, evenly distributed weight growth condition, workforce efficient, since all equipments are run by motors, low mortality rate and room temperature can be controlled. While disadvantages were such as large investment costs, requires high power source and backup generators, needs high skill and broad knowledge technically. Meanwhile, the success of royal chicken farming is not only dependent on shed system, but also good seed selection, feed formulation, and livestock management maintenance. Okay, the next, I will read the resume from Dr. Dedi Jusadi. Based raw materials for aquaculture feeds have been fish meal and fish oil. Plant-based raw materials have replaced them in major amount, but specific means are needed to fulfill nutritional requirement of fish. Feed is one of the biggest costs of fish farming. Pay attention to scientific feeding methods. It is not only conducive to the healthy growth of the fish, but also can save the feed and effectively improve the benefit of fish culture. Nutrient requirement of fish are a complex process. When choosing comprehensive feed formula, we should start from the existing raw materials, develop new protein source, fat, carbohydrate, which is suitable either for marine or freshwater fishes. Feed production and formulation has related with the fish behavior. Recommended aquaculture feeding strategies is needed to be a special formula for freshwater and seawater fish. What is the right strategy in making feed formula, especially if we manipulate the environment on marine fish that want to cultivate it using freshwater? And the last one is resume from Dr. Marcel. The animal health sector is embracing the global push to achieve the SDGs by 2030. Currently, one in five animals in the food chain is lost due to preventable disease. This is not only a threat to animal welfare, it's a waste of limited natural resources. Animals that struggle with disease will need more resources to aid in their recovery and may never produce as much than if they did not fall ill. Healthy livestock are simply more productive. This is why preventive care like vaccination or good nutrition are important in continually improving livestock sustainability. Good nutrition improves the natural immunity of an animal, similar to when people take vitamin supplement. While vaccine built on this foundation, other steps such as improving biosecurity, for example, by rearing more animals indoors, keep disease away, animals together. However, disease can never be fully prevented. When it strikes, intervention with targeted treatment like antibiotics can help an animal recover quickly. Also, there are several innovations changing animal health, such as artificial intelligence in dairy farming, advances in vaccine technology, until genetic. Okay, I guess that's my resume for the three speakers. And next, I would like to thank you so much for the speaker, Dr. Desianto, Dr. Dedi, Dr. Marcel, for the wonderful presentation, and to all of the audience for their participation. And until now, we still have up to 124 participants. Thank you for your enthusiasm toward this webinar. Hopefully, this webinar will be beneficial for everyone. But thank you so much, audience. I would like to give applause. I would like to ask audience to give applause to our speakers by clicking the
thank you very much
reaction. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
And back to the master of ceremony in this webinar, Mrs. Vega.
Okay, thank you. That's a wonderful presentation.
Thank you, all of the speakers.
Thank you, Dr. Heriu, for moderating us today. Well, that's all we got for you here today. So thank you for joining our webinar to discuss innovation in integrated animal sector in new normal era. We appreciate your signing in and hope you learn the topic that we delivered today. And don't forget, before we sign off, I'd love to tell you about our next webinar entitled In Triple Helix Platform to Improve Innovation in Agricultural Sector. It will be held by tomorrow. Just feel free to reach out to us, yeah, via Instagram and our YouTube, Sekolah Vokasi IPB, if you're interested or want to know more, yeah. Okay, all participants, yeah, all media partners and all industrial partners, and so our students and the university, we'll see you next time. Good day and take your
Thank you very much, Pak Desi, Pak Marcel.
Izin live ya.
Yes.
Monggo Bapak.
Thank you.
Izin live ya. Terima kasih.
Sukses, salam sehat semua ya.
Sehat-sehat selalu.
Amin.
Pak Desi.
Halo sehat semua. Assalamualaikum.
Terima kasih.
Waalaikumsalam.
Waalaikumsalam. Terima kasih, Pak. Thank you. Thank you, Dok Heriu. Thank you, Mbak Ima.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Dr. Heriu, thank you very much.
Yeah. So I will leave the meeting. Thank you, Miss Ima.
Yes, Miss Vega.
Maraming salamat.
Salamat.
Maraming salamat.
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 Salamat, everyone.
Selamat
Ini videonya nggak ada suaranya, Mbak Ima.
Iya, Pak Pria, ini nggak ada suaranya. Sepertinya share-nya belum share with audio.
Terima kasih banyak Pak Heryu.
Terima kasih, terima kasih kesempatannya Pak Pria.
Keren nih, keren moderatornya. Siap-siap next time lagi.
masih banyak loh yang keren-keren.
Bima ya, harus Pak Heryu nih nanti disiapkan lagi nih. Next time.
Banyak yang keren-keren dibanding saya ya. Bu Desi, terima kasih Bu Desi. Halo Bu Desi. Bu Desi ada nggak nih Bu Desi? Bu Desi masih with us?
Udah live.
Oh, udah live, oke.
English is my second language. As a vlogger, I deal with social.
Halo, Pak Irza.
Social media a lot, which is actually fun for me, but I will say sometimes it's challenging.
Kampus terbaik, inspirasi, tebarkan harapan. Kampus terbaik, inovasi, wujudkan impian. Kampus terbaik, integritas, kuatkan tujuan. Kampus terbaik, beri terbaik untuk negeri, untuk dunia, umat manusia dan alam semesta. Mari bersama hadirkan masa depan dalam langkah dan pikiran agar selalu terdepan berbekal ilmu dan jiwa pengabdian. Deras arus zaman takkan tertahan, majulah melangkah, oh majulah. Kampus terbaik, inspirasi, tebarkan harapan. Kampus terbaik, inovasi, wujudkan impian. Kampus terbaik, integritas, kuatkan tujuan. Kampus terbaik, beri terbaik untuk negeri, untuk dunia, umat manusia, dan alam semesta. Mari bersama hadirkan masa depan dalam langkah dan pikiran agar selalu terdepan berbekal ilmu dan jiwa pengabdian. Deras arus zaman takkan tertahan, majulah melangkah, oh majulah.
Kita ada evaluasi nggak ya? Masih di mute, Mbak. Sorry. Still muted. Ini kita mau ada apa lagi ya? Udah ya.
Mbak Ima.
Bu Ima.
Masih di mute Mbak Ima?
Masih di mute.
Hostnya mesti unmute. Because I cannot unmute.
Biasanya sudah sih Pak Heryu. Nanti mungkin tunggu Bu Ima ya.
Ini masih banyak yang stay di room ya?
Iya.
I believe Bu Daisy are not with us right now. And Bima. Also the rest.
Ya.
Yeah. Yeah. Baik, Bu Ima.
Berikutnya apa, Bu Ima?
Gak apa-apa, leave room aja ya. Nanti akan diinfokan lagi. Dokter, yuk.
Okay. Thank you so much. Makasih, for having me ya. Maaf kalau gak maksimal ya.
Enggak kok, maksimal sekali, thank you banget dok.
Soalnya biasanya kalau menanggap aku lagi enggak sehat. Ada aja.
Enggak apa selalu, tapi maksimal kok dok Heryu. Thank you banget. Ya, sehat selalu ya dok Heryu ya.
Kenapa? Oh iya.
Sehat selalu, iya.
Amin. Yang lain sehat-sehat selalu ya. Saya leave.
Terima kasih Dokter Heryu.
Terima kasih Dokter Heryu.
Terima kasih.
Iya. Iya.
Pak Pria bisa
izin pamit Bu Ima ya.
Pak Pria. Di end meeting for all aja, Pak.